Now let us see the propagation of electromagnetic waves in isotropic dielectric. Now what is an isotropic dielectric? A non-conducting medium whose properties are same in all directions is known as an isotropic dielectric. Now from Maxwell's field equations we have del dot D equal to rho, del dot B equal to 0, del cross H equal to J plus dou D by dou T and del cross E equal to minus dou B by dou T, where D is the electric current displacement vector, B is the magnetic induction vector, H is the magnetic field, J is the current density, E is the electric field. Now let name this equation number 1. Now using J, the current density equal to sigma E, where sigma is the conductivity, B equal to mu H, where mu is the magnetic permeability, and D equal to epsilon E, where epsilon is the permittivity. And using the fact that sigma equal to 0 and rho equal to 0 for a non-conducting medium, so these Maxwell's equations will reduce to del dot E equal to 0, del dot H equal to 0, curl of H equal to epsilon dou E by dou T, and curl of E equal to minus mu dou H by dou T. So let this be equation A, B, C and D, and these are equation number 2. Now using curl in equation number 2C, that is curl of H equal to epsilon curl of dou E by dou T, and using the vector identity A cross B cross C, we have del dot H minus del H equal to epsilon curl of dou E by dou T, and we can write it as this equal to epsilon and dou by dou T curl of E. Now using the fact that del dot H equal to 0 and curl of E equal to minus mu dou H by dou T, we have minus del square H equal to minus mu epsilon dou 2H by dou T square, and we can write it as del square H equal to mu epsilon dou 2H by dou T square. So this equation becomes del square H minus mu epsilon dou 2H by dou T square equal to 0. Or we can write this as del square H minus 1 by V square dou 2H by dou T square equal to 0. Let us name this equation number A. Now, again taking the curl of equation 2D, that is curl of E equal to curl of minus mu dou H by dou T, and again using the vector identity, we have del dot E minus del dot del E equal to minus mu dou by dou T del cross H. Now, using the fact that del dot E equal to 0 and del cross H equal to epsilon dou E by dou T, we can write the above equation as minus del square E equal to minus mu epsilon dou 2E by dou T square, or this equation becomes del square E minus mu epsilon dou 2E by dou T square equal to 0. Or we can write it as del square E minus 1 by V square dou 2E by dou T square equal to 0. So, this is equation number B. In both the cases, in equation number A and equation number B, 1 by V square is equal to mu epsilon, or 1 by V equal to under root mu epsilon, or V equal to 1 by under root mu epsilon. Now we have a standard wave equation. Traveling with a speed V is given by del square psi minus 1 by V square dou 2 psi by dou T square equal to 0. Let this be equation number 5. And the solution of this equation is given by psi equal to psi naught to the power minus I omega t minus k dot r, where omega is the angular frequency, k is the wave vector, and r is the space point where we are looking at the wave. Now, comparing the equation 5, we can say that the electric field and the magnetic field both travel with a speed v in form of wave in a isotropic dielectric medium, and E vector can be written as E naught e to the power minus I omega t minus k dot r, and H equal to H naught e to the power minus I omega t minus k dot r. Now, both these vectors travel at speed v given by 1 by mu epsilon under root, and this is equal to 1 by under root mu r mu naught epsilon r epsilon naught, and this is equal to c by under root mu r epsilon r, since c is equal to 1 by under root mu naught epsilon naught. Therefore, we see that v equal to c by mu r epsilon r, and since epsilon r and mu r both are greater than 1, so we find that V equal to C by mu r epsilon r under root is less than C. That is, the speed of electromagnetic wave in isotropic dielectric is less than the speed of electromagnetic waves in free space. Further, we know that refractive index n asterisk is given by speed of light in free space or vacuum by speed of light in that medium. So in this case, we have n asterisk is equal to C by V, and this is equal to under root mu r epsilon r. And for a non-magnetic material, we have mu r equal to 1. Therefore, n asterisk in this case will be equal to under root epsilon r, or n asterisk square equal to epsilon r. Now let us name this equation V is less than C as equation number 6 and n square equal to epsilon r as equation number 7. The equation 7 is called Maxwell's relation and has been actually confirmed by experiments for long waves, that is radio frequency and slow infrared oscillations. In visible region of the spectrum, this relation is also fairly well satisfied for some substances like hydrogen, carbon dioxide, nitrogen, oxygen, etc. But for many other substances, it fails when, as a rule, the substance shows infrared selection absorption. With water, the failure is especially marked. For water, mu r is approximately equal to 1 and epsilon r is approximately equal to 81, so that the refractive index n asterisk should be equal to 9. But it is well known that the index of refraction of water for light is very closely given by 4/3, that is 1.33. The solution of this apparent contradiction lies in the fact that our macroscopic formulation of electromagnetic theory gives no indication of the values to be expected for epsilon r and mu r, and we must rely on experiment to obtain them. It turns out that these quantities are not really constant, but for a given material, but usually have a strong dependence on frequency due to dispersion. Now writing del equal to ik and dou by dou t equal to minus I omega, the Maxwell's equations can be written as k dot E equal to 0, k dot h equal to 0, minus k cross h equal to omega epsilon e, and k cross e equal to omega mu h. So these are A, B, C, D, and these are equation number 8, where k is the wave propagation vector. It is equal to k equal to k and scalar value k and multiplied by unit vector n cap in the direction of the propagation of the wave, and this is equal to 2 pi by lambda n cap, and this is equal to 2 pi f by v n cap. F is the frequency and v is the velocity, and so we have this one equal to omega by v n cap, where omega is the angular frequency. So equation 8 gives the Maxwell's equation of the electromagnetic waves traveling in an isotropic dielectric. That is, k dot E equal to 0, k dot H equal to 0, minus k cross H equal to omega epsilon E, and k cross E equal to omega mu H. Now let us see some of the consequences of the propagation of electromagnetic waves in isotropic dielectric. Number one, the vectors E, H and K are orthogonal. That is, the electromagnetic waves is transverse in nature and the electric and the magnetic vectors are mutually perpendicular. So this can be easily seen by using the Maxwell's equation in the form K dot E equal to 0, K dot H equal to 0, K cross H minus K cross H equal to omega epsilon E, and K cross E equal to omega mu H. This is A, this is B, this is C, and this is equation D, and we had named this equation 8. Now from equation 8a, K dot E equal to 0, this means E is, vector E is perpendicular to vector K, that is E is perpendicular to the direction of propagation. Now from equation B, K dot H equal to 0, that is H is perpendicular to K, that is magnetic field is perpendicular to the direction of propagation. Now from equation C, minus K cross H equal to omega epsilon E, this means E is perpendicular both to K and H. E perpendicular to K and E is perpendicular to H. Also from equation K cross E equal to omega mu H, we see that H is perpendicular both to K and E. So we find that H, K and E are mutually orthogonal or mutually perpendicular, and also E and H are perpendicular to the direction of the propagation of the wave. That is, the electromagnetic waves in isotropic dielectric are transverse in nature. Now the second consequence, the vectors E and H are in phase and their magnitudes are related to each other by the relation, that is the ratio of the magnitudes of E by H is equal to E naught by H naught is equal to under root mu R by epsilon R into Z naught, and this is equal to Z. Here Z is called the impedance of the medium and Z naught is the characteristic impedance of the free space. Now this can be easily seen from the Maxwell's equation, K cross E equal to omega mu H, we have H equal to 1 by mu omega K cross E. Now we can write K equal to magnitude of K and unit vector n cap. So the above equation becomes K cross E, that is equal to omega mu H, is H equal to 1 by mu omega K n cap cross E. Also we know that K equal to omega by V. So using this we have H equal to 1 by mu omega omega by V n cap cross E, or we have H vector equal to 1 by mu v n cap cross E. Now we know the value of v is equal to 1 by under root mu epsilon. Using this in the above equation, we have H equal to 1 by mu and 1 by mu epsilon under root n cap cross E. So we can write it as H equal to 1 by under root mu by epsilon and n cross E. And this can be written as n cross E by under root mu naught mu r by epsilon naught epsilon r. And this can be written as n cap cross E by under root mu naught by epsilon naught multiplied by mu under root mu r by epsilon r. Or H is equal to n cross E n cap cross E by z naught into mu r by epsilon r, where z naught is equal to the intrinsic or characteristic impedance of free space given by z naught equal to under root mu naught by epsilon naught. Therefore, the ratio of the magnitudes of E by H, that is equal to z naught into mu r by epsilon r under root, and we can write it as z, the impedance of the medium. The third consequence is that the direction of flow of energy is in the direction in which the wave propagates, and the pointing vector is n asterisk by mu r, that is the refractive index by the relative permeability times of the pointing vector, if the same wave propagates through the free space. Now this can be shown as follows. Vector H is equal to n cap cross E by the impedance of the medium, that is Z. Now the pointing vector S is equal to E cross H. So writing the value of H from above, we have this equal to E cross n cap cross E by Z. Now using the vector identity A cross B cross C in the above, this becomes 1 by Z and n cap E dot E minus E E dot n cap. As we know, E dot n cap is equal to 0, so the above becomes 1 by Z E square n cap. That is, the pointing vector S equal to E square n cap. Now this can be written as E square n cap by Z, and we know Z is equal to Z naught under root mu r by epsilon r. Now this can be written as E square n cap by Z naught and multiplying by mu r in the numerator and the denominator, that is mu r square by epsilon r mu r, and this is equal to E square n cap by Z naught mu r, and we have got this equal to n asterisk as under root epsilon r mu r is equal to n asterisk the refractive index. So this is equal to e square n asterisk n cap by z naught mu r. Again, we can write it as e square n asterisk n cap by, in place of z naught, we can write under root mu naught by epsilon naught and mu r. Now, this can be written as e square n asterisk n cap by multiplying by mu naught epsilon naught by epsilon naught, and this becomes equal to e square n asterisk n cap by under root mu naught epsilon naught, and epsilon naught goes in the numerator, that is epsilon naught e square n asterisk by under root mu naught epsilon naught n cap. And we know that 1 by epsilon naught mu naught under root is equal to c. So this becomes epsilon naught c e square n asterisk n cap as 1 by mu naught epsilon naught under root is equal to c. Therefore, the pointing vector s is equal to epsilon naught c e square n asterisk n cap. Now, if we take the average value of this, that is s average, that is average value of the pointing vector, this becomes equal to epsilon naught c e square average n asterisk n cap. And we know that the average value of e square is equal to e rms square. So this becomes epsilon naught c e rms square and n cap, and there is n asterisk. So we see that the average value of s is equal to n asterisk, and there is a mu r here, we have left it, so write it mu r here, and there will be mu r here, and there will be mu r here, and there will be mu r here. So n asterisk by mu r epsilon naught c e rms square n cap. So we find that the pointing vector in this case, the average value of the pointing vector in this case is n asterisk by mu r times the average value of the pointing vector if the wave would have been traveling in the free space. Now, the fourth consequence is that the electromagnetic energy density is equal to the magnetostatic energy density, and the total energy density is epsilon r times that of the energy density if the same wave propagates through free space and the electromagnetic energy is transmitted with the same velocity with which the fields do. This can be seen as follows. Now, the electrostatic energy density UE is equal to half epsilon E square, and the magnetostatic energy density UM is equal to half mu H square. Now, the ratio of UE by UM is equal to half epsilon E square by half mu H square. This is equal to epsilon E square by mu H square, and this is equal to epsilon by mu E by H whole square, and this is equal to 1 as E by H under root is equal to mu by epsilon. So from this we get the value of the electrostatic energy density UE is equal to UM. Now the total energy density U is given by the sum of UE and UM, that is U equal to UE plus UM, and this is equal to UE plus UE, as UE is equal to UM, Therefore, U is equal to 2UE, and this is equal to 2 into half epsilon E square. And this is equal to epsilon E square, or U in this case is written as epsilon naught epsilon R E square. This is equal to epsilon R epsilon naught E square. So we find that the total energy density is epsilon R times that of the energy density of the same wave when propagating in free space. Now further, the average value of the pointing vector S is equal to n asterisk by mu r epsilon naught c e rms square n cap, and the average value of u is equal to epsilon naught epsilon r average value of e square, and we know that the average value of e square is equal to e rms square, so we can write it as equal to epsilon naught epsilon r e rms square. Therefore, the ratio of the average value of pointing vector S by the total energy density U is equal to n asterisk by mu r epsilon naught c e rms square n cap by epsilon naught epsilon r e rms square. So we are left with n asterisk by mu r epsilon r and n cap. So now we know that mu r epsilon r under root is equal to n asterisk. Therefore, mu r epsilon r equal to n asterisk square. Putting the value in the above equation, we get the average value of the pointing vector by the average value of the total energy density is equal to n asterisk n cap by n asterisk square. And there is epsilon n asterisk square. So, and there is c here. So this becomes, so there will be a c here, which I have left out, c here. So c n asterisk n cap by n asterisk square. So this becomes equal to c by n asterisk n cap. Now we know that n asterisk is equal to c by v. Therefore, c by n asterisk is equal to v. Therefore, s by u is equal to v into n cap, and so we can write s equal to v u n cap. So we see that the electromagnetic energy is transmitted with the same velocity v with which the fields do. So this is all about the propagation of electromagnetic waves through an isotropic dielectric medium.